Hello everyone and welcome to another exciting video in the SpeakIn's Managing Change series, where we bring you reliable information from the finest of our experts. I hope all of you and your families are keeping safe. Our guest for today's episode is one of the world's most respected medical professionals. He has served as the honorary surgeon to the President of India and His Holiness Dalai Lama. He is the Executive Vice Chairman of the Max Healthcare, the Chairman of the Minimal Access Metabolic and Bariatric Surgery and Allied Surgical Specialties of the Max Healthcare Institute, and has been listed in the Guinness Book of World Records and the Limca Book of Records for more than 80,000 minimal access surgeries performed by a surgeon. I am 100% sure that his complete introduction would supersede the duration of this entire interview. And without further ado, it is my pleasure to introduce to you Padma Shri Dr. Pradeep Chowbey. A very warm welcome, Dr. Chowbey, and thank you for joining us today.
Thank you very much. It's a pleasure.
Pleasure is all ours, Dr. Chowbey. So our viewers are eagerly looking forward to hearing from you. Hence, let us not, you know, keep them waiting. And I'll straight away start with the first question. So, Dr. Chowbey, with the current COVID-19 pandemic that we are going through, there is a lot of negativity and people seem extremely pessimistic about every turn of events. What is your perspective on the entire crisis that we are in?
Well, I think I would like to say that this endemic and pandemic is inevitable. What I mean to say is that it has started. It has to end. One day it will definitely end. And our aim should be that it should end, maybe not on a lesser evil and lesser sufferings and lesser loss of life, and with the minimum discomfort to any individual, to the family, and to the society, and to the country, and to the world. So, first of all, we have to accept that it is a reality. So we have to face it. And I feel that there's no point in becoming panic about it, because what I have seen that the fear should be replaced by knowledge. Because we know that fear appears when you know nothing about it. So if you know facts and figures about this COVID virus, and that should come from the scientific background, not with the type of news which we are getting on various social medias, which even frighten us as well, because we know that it is not true. But if you really look at them, then you feel that yes, if it is true, then it is bad.
Right, certainly, couldn't agree more, sir. So, Dr. Chowbey, also people in these times are certainly, you know, scared, and fear often leads to belief in myths and, you know, sometimes even over precautions. What are some of the myths that everyone seem to believe about the coronavirus these days and, you know, regarding how it spreads? We have seen a lot of people, you know, going out of their way to protect themselves, and they are, you know, overly cautious about these things. So what do you think, you know, some of the myths which everyone seems to believe these days?
Well, I think just to take away the myth, I would need to summarize what exactly it is. First of all, I think it is one of the virus which is normally seen of the COVID group of the virus, appeared in 19, so it is known as a COVID-19. Now, this virus basically belongs to the mammals group, and it got mutated for the human damages, which is now it is doing. Now, I know that no disease can be considered as a good disease, but when you will know about this particular virus, I'm sure it will make you less uncomfortable and less anxious. That fortunately, this virus it has got its own negativity, but there are, according to me as a medical person, there are quite a few positive aspects of this virus. First of all, this virus is one of the heaviest virus. Now, when the virus is very heavy, that means that the transmission will fall down with the gravity, right? The gravity works all over the earth, and we are living on the earth. So gravity is going to be friendly with us as far as this virus is concerned. It's a heavy virus. So what happens, because the virus is heavy, it will not be transmitted through the air pollution. It's not, you know, like if you look at many other viruses which are, you know, dispersed and infect the people by air pollution. So you have to breathe a good air. So with this virus, because it's heavy, generally speaking, if the patient who's suffering from COVID infection, and if he coughs, possibly the cough will not go beyond 3 feet from the person. And if he sneezes, which is a high pressure expulsion of the virus, probably it will go to maybe about 6 feet or so, maybe 2 meters. So that means that, and then it falls down on the ground, right? And another point which everyone should know, that the virus, though they are not parasite, but they are just a protein mass of RNA and DNA. So it needs some cell to survive. So their energy, their nutrition comes from the cell. So in this case, it needs a human cell to go. It cannot penetrate the skin cell. So it has got an affinity for mucous membrane, that is nose, okay, mouth, eyes, you know, these are the common sort of thing. And when it comes out, it is sort of spread in a periphery of about 6 feet at the most, we can say. And then what the person may do is sneeze or touch his mouth, or, you know, and that is how it comes to the hands. So next thing is that it comes to the hand, and in hand, again, because it's a skin, it is not going to survive. It's not going to penetrate your skin and survive. It will survive only when you come in contact with the nasal mucosa or mouth or eyes, for that matter. And the infection from here, it may come from your hand. You may put your fingers in your eyes, or you touch your face, and then it can enter. So we should know from where it can come and what is the entry point. So it makes it simple to understand that if you are away from somebody more than 6 feet or 7 feet, then you are absolutely safe as far as the droplet infections are concerned. So that means that if anybody is coughing or sneezing, so you have to keep the distance, and that is what is the why we insist on social distancing. You know, you have to be away from each other more than 6 feet, even if the person is infected, or the person may not be infected, maybe carrying the virus. So if you are away from that person, then you are safe. Second comes the transmission. Suppose you shake hands with the person, or you touch his any part of the body with your hands, then what? How you can avoid? You have to have hand sanitization. So if you do hand sanitization, and if you maintain a social distance, then I think this is a very, very good news, because these two things are practically simple to follow, provided you understand them. As far as the hand sanitization is concerned, I feel that the best hand sanitizer is soap and water, you know, of 20 to 30 seconds duration, which is not much. You just count 20 or 30, then it's all done, because the soap will destroy the, because this has got a lipid sort of, you know, is a fatty shell. So this soap, we know that it will remove fat and it will destroy. And also you will wash the virus load, dead virus load, into the water, into the sink. And if you don't have available soap and water, then the role of sanitization comes by the sanitizers. So it does not mean that if you don't have a sanitizer, this is going to sort of catch you. But yes, role of sanitizer is when you are away, when the water and soap is not available. Even if you are in some hotel place, now I think that situation has gone, because we are all at our own home and our residence. So you have enough water, enough soap, just very frequently as you can, wash your soap and water. Next comes social distancing, you know. So I think our Prime Minister has taken a very, very bold and very scientific decision and a very courageous decision to announce these 3 weeks of social distancing and, you know, in a way, shut down all the possibilities from where this infection can come. So if you follow it as it is meant for our own benefit and our family's benefit, I'm sure the country will be really benefited with that. Very simple to follow, very simple to understand. So my submission will be to, first you understand the situation, what the situation is, understand the science behind it, what is a heavy virus, how can it be transmitted, and third, take prevention and precautions as explained. These are the two absolutely, see, if it would have been airborne, I think the whole country would have suffered.
Right.
Because everybody has to, you know, inhale air. Mm-hmm. So we must be really thankful that it is a heavy virus and it is not, you cannot develop it by just going out. Airborne transmission is not there.
Right, perfect. Very interesting point indeed. I mean, even I was not very sure about the, you know, virus coming in contact with the skin cells. But as Dr. Chowbey has, you know, pointed out that the virus only affects, you know, when it comes with the, you know, mucous membrane or, you know, and it does not at all affect the skin cells. So that is something to, you know, note and something that you all can get behind. And there is no need to be very panicky and overly precautious. So thank you so much for this information, Dr. Chowbey. I'll come to the third point, which is my third question for you is, the nature at present seems to be healing herself with all the humans locked inside their rooms. The effect can already be seen on the environment. Is the COVID-19 pandemic a warning and a wake-up call for the humankind?
Well, I think in every century, you will have one or two wake-up calls like this. And it's a godsend. It's we also should also appreciate the nature. What I mean by nature is that we all are born by half cell, male cell and half female cell. Then such a complex system develops out of that. And God and nature would always like to destroy it. And that's why we say that the birth and death, these are the 200% things which are going to happen to everybody. I mean, there's no pessimism in this. It's absolutely optimism. I think, yes, I would feel that this sort of things come because, look, you know, a couple of decades back, mosquitoes were a big nuisance and you just sprayed the DDT and all mosquito died, you know. If you shout DDT and the mosquito will die, it was as bad. But see, over a period of time, DDT has lost its effect because nature wants to maintain and sustain the mosquitoes also. So they have mutated them, they have changes which have taken place, and that has also sort of in a way helped the mosquitoes to survive DDT. Then we keep on. So antibiotic, penicillin today, penicillin is practically of no use because at one time it really saves millions and millions of life. But today penicillin, the bacteria, the organisms have developed that sort of, you know, resistance to that penicillin. So we are coming out with newer and better antibiotics. So what I'm trying to say is that, yes, God would create such situations where people are like to die, but I think whatever we can prevent, whatever we can do, I'm sure the medical fraternity and all of us, we do exactly the same. So wherever we've been, finally, of course, yes, you have to give in one day to the nature and to the God, whatever you believe in, and say, okay, this is the last moment of anybody's life.
Wow, very, very interesting take. Very interesting take indeed. Coming to the next question. We are seeing tremendous lifestyle changes owing to the COVID-19. I mean, at the same time, some people seem to be extremely paranoid about the situation, while some people are even scared to step out, even in their balconies and gardens. Others are practicing ostracization against people from Northeast, people who have just returned from abroad, and even doctors. this is a huge problem that we are seeing right now. What would you like to comment on this situation, and what can you put out your word regarding the situation to the people out there who are practicing all these social evils?
Well, I think this is again, I would say this is a thought process, negative thought process of few individuals who are absolutely pessimist, who may be under depression and I would say very illiterate and very negative. They must be very negative in their life, you know. There's so many things every time, so many times in a year, we all get common cold. And this virus also produces something like common cold. The unfortunate part of this is, if one gets infected by this, the mortality is little more than what is expected of a common cold, you know. So it's because it's a very aggressive virus. So that's again is a medical fact. And what we are going to do, I think, you know, I'm a doctor, I'm a surgeon. So suppose I stop operating emergency patients, what will happen? How anybody will feel? But what about when the person will develop a COVID? I think he has to be managed, helped by the doctor, paramedical staff, nurses, you know. So we put so much at risk. We are not soldiers.
Exactly.
Because when you join an army, you know that you have to face. You have got a gun with you. You have, you know, so much of a support with you. But as a medical person, it's a certain sort of thing. Medical world was not aware of this particular virus and its problems and this thing. So we are trying to gear up, and I would also really pay my respect and salute to the doctor community and the paramedical staff and the corporate hospitals and the government hospitals, the nursing homes, with the support of the government. And government has been absolutely proactive, very proactive. I mean, again, I would say that they have done it at absolutely right time when India was supposed to enter into the community transfer third phase, which is a community spread of this disease, which can explode and kill maybe a huge part of the human population. So I think, you know, we are, I'm quite optimistic. You see, 5-7 days now, if you really look at the graph, we have just crossed about 1,000 cases. We should have crossed, if not this situation, we would have crossed maybe 10-15,000, maybe more positive cases. So I think it's a great positive indication that we will win over this battle with minimum harm, provided, of course, you and me support and the doctors support the government's instructions and do not resist. That's what I'm saying. There's so much of to do in life. Why don't you just reinvent yourself, rediscover your family, rediscover the talent which is available in the family, look at what you wanted to do in life, what hobbies you wanted to pursue. I think this gives us a lifetime opportunity of 3 weeks to do introspection, what things we were not doing good, which is not good to our health. Maybe we were not aware of those things. And so many times I would say that you did not know what your family member is capable of, what talents your children, your wife, your grandchildren, your, even for that matter, your staff, though they have so much of talent. But because we were all running on the fast track, we did not have much time to stop and think over. Possibly. To me, I've taken it as a golden period of 3 weeks, which I can do a lot within 5-7 days. I've realized that what we all were missing as a family, as an individual, as in our own hobby. So I think people will remember, I can assure you, after 3 weeks, people will remember such a wonderful time we had with the family. though little inconveniences are there, but these inconveniences are hardly anything. In the modern world, you have got all internet available to you, all the television programs, so many things which are available to you. You can do a community sort of, you know, through internet community discussions. You can really play music with the community. You can play games with internet and so many things. So you should look at the positive side rather than a little inconvenience here and there, which is minuscule of what otherwise we will go through when we become sick and develop the country develops that sort of thing. It will all fizzle out because there's no medical facilities which can handle thousands and thousands of such infected person.
Oh, understood. Completely understood. And I would like to add here personally that our doctors and our medical community at this time are no less than the soldiers who are, you know, out there risking our lives for the protection of us. So big salute to doctors like yourself and the entire medical community who are out there looking after us. Thank you so much for that, Dr. Chowbey. And of course, I mean, as many people are asking us regarding what to do within this 21-day lockdown, as you rightly mentioned, this is a time to, you know, reintrospect, just, you know, spend time with family. There is no need to be depressed and there is no need to be feel like, there is no need to feel isolated. So really appreciate your words on that, Dr. Chowbey. Coming to the next question, and this is a question that we are really getting a lot. One of the biggest reasons that coronavirus is so scary is that there is no vaccine against this as of now. A lot of people want to know why the vaccine is not yet developed and why is it taking so long. So, Dr. Chowbey, when can we possibly see the anti-COVID vaccine?
Well, I think we cannot really depend on the vaccine at this stage, you know, because first of all, this corona COVID-19 was not known to us because it's a virus which affects the bats, you know. It's a bats virus and it has mutated to affect the human being. So, it's, I mean, why should the medical science look into the COVID-19? It was never affected the human beings, you know. It was basically for the bats to be affected. But having said that, see, I think you must understand the mechanism. First, we have to understand the virus. We have to see the RNA chains which are there in the virus. And then you have to create antibodies, which is a protein which is totally opposite to this protein of COVID-19. And that you have to grow that and develop that and then create vaccines, you know. And then vaccine will be used as prevention. And it takes a hell of a long time. And maybe the fastest time which I can think, it can never be developed. No vaccine can be developed within a year or maybe 18 months or maybe 24 months. Because it's a very tedious process. It's not, it's very time consuming. So it's not that today you know and then you have antidote tomorrow. No, it is, it's going to take. So we should not think of vaccine at all, you know. I think we have got influenza vaccine after so many years of getting influenza, maybe dengue, maybe so many other virus thing. And I think we should be really thankful that this COVID-19 is not transmitted through mosquito. Suppose it would have been transmitting the disease through mosquito, I think country like India would have faced such a severe challenge that you cannot kill the mosquitoes of the country, you know. So I think these are the some positive points of this COVID-19. Prevention is the best, social distancing is the best, and hand wash, hand sanitization is the best way to avoid completely. You don't need a vaccination. Maybe when, as and when the vaccination come, it may prevent, but then nature would probably mutate this virus into maybe COVID XX, which year it mutates, you never know. So what your COVID-19 vaccination will go waste. Like what happened to smallpox vaccination? It's gone. It's not available. It's not of any use. What happened to the polio vaccination? It's only for the children now. I think the country is polio free and smallpox free, you know. So I think we should not really rely on the vaccine at all. It's going to take a long time. Just follow the social distancing and sanitization, and this will take care of this sort of infections which are going to. And then the community develops a sort of, you know, community sort of protection, natural protection.
Perfect. Perfectly said. And just to reiterate, as Dr. Chowbey just mentioned, we should not wait up for the vaccine. We should do our bit to keep ourselves safe, because vaccine, you know, might the development of vaccine might take a couple of more months. So we should not totally wait up for the vaccine and, you know, be careless that a vaccine will be developed. We should practice social distancing. Very well said, Dr. Chowbey. And coming to the, you know, one of the last questions, after that maybe we can take one or two questions we have received from our audience. How can we best fight against coronavirus while at the same time keeping ourselves and our families safe? And is there any other advice that you would like to give to our viewers?
Well, I think you have to take social separation a little more seriously. So it is within the family, and some of our family members, if develops common cold, etc., which could be surely a COVID infection. So keep that person in a separate room. Do not interact much. Keep the distance, and that person, you know, can be given separate food on a disposable sort of thing. And I can assure you that most of these things will settle down within the family. It's quite possible the other family members also may not develop at all, you know. It is as preventable as that. Even in a family, if you seclude that person, isolate that person, it's not that you close the windows and air conditioning and this and that, not to that extent. But I think it is possible to do that. Second place where I think we do not follow is, do not get people from outside. Don't try to socialize. I think this is the commonest thing in this last week, which I have seen. People say, we are just living four blocks away. Why don't you just come over in the evening? We will have some fun. That's not to be done. You should be working more. Don't let your mates come as a part-time, because those are the person who can bring the infection from outside, because they are the persons who are meeting. So do it all your work. As much as possible, do not. If you have a staff at home, let them not go out. I mean, they will help you. Even if you have to work a little more, how does it matter? After all, when we go on a holiday, we have to wash our clothes and we have to wash our utensils. So why not? I mean, as I said, it's acceptance. So these are things to be avoided. But don't be afraid of a newspaper. Somebody is getting you a newspaper. It's not a way to transmit this virus. And you should not that you're not going to talk to somebody on telephone, you're not going to talk on a video conferencing. Do that. There are a lot of apps which have come now. You can play games, you can play cards on the game, you can play chess, whatever you feel, you know. You can have an orchestra. You play drums, somebody plays guitar, somebody plays piano on this, and it can make a very good recording, you know, which you will remember that during that period we created so many songs. Somebody has lost, okay, and you can even bet also. You can play cards and you can bet, okay, so I owe 100 rupees to Himanshu to be paid after this period is over.
Agreed. Very well said. So I think I'll have one of the questions. So I have Mr. Saurabh, who has a question that currently, is the medical infrastructure in India ready to cope up with the challenge of COVID-19?
Yeah, very, very interesting. And this is what we are fighting for. And this is what the social distancing will do. Because if you have 1,000 patients coming to any, suppose, you know, institution, how can you handle 1,000 patients of one disease? The hospitals and the medical fraternity are prepared and geared for a particular number. You know, say, suppose somebody is coming to your home for a dinner, you don't expect 500 people coming for dinner. How can you feed 500 people for a dinner? You expect 5, 10, 20, maybe 15. Instead of 15, maybe 20 will come. But if 200 people come, how can you feed them? So, rightly so.
Exactly.
So, medically, as a doctor, as a, you know, responsible person of a big chain of max healthcare, what our aim is to stagger it, to flatten that curve. So suppose there are 10 patients coming every day for this infection, we can very efficiently handle it. But if 1,000 people come, we cannot handle it. So what we want, that we should have minimum possible patients coming to us. Because I think you must understand that it's not the patient care also. We have to take care of our own self, of our own doctors, nurses, you know. The, you know, that PPE, the professional protection equipment, which is a limited supply to the, many of us for when we are operating the infected patients of infectious diseases. But we are not prepared to operate 10 cases, because every PPE, professional protection equipment, needs to be changed every time. And you know, with this PPE, you cannot drink water, you cannot eat coffee, you cannot go to the washroom, you can do nothing. So you have to change the whole PPE equipment. If you say, suppose you want to go to the washroom, you have to take out all the two layers of PPE and have a new equipment coming in, you know. And so when the duty changes, you imagine in ICU, suppose there are 20 persons working in on a duty, and we have to reduce the working hours, 4 to 6 hours, not beyond that, because you cannot hold on starving and not going to the washroom for such a long period. So we have to have more frequent changes of the duty roster. And that means that you need more PPEs, you know, number of PPEs are more. So what I mean is that we are reasonably equipped at the moment for a reasonable number. But if this gets staggered over a few weeks and months, then I think practically the whole country will be geared with a large number of ventilators, a large number of PPE, large number of our medical personnel and infrastructure and the medications. So if our curve gets flattened, I can assure you, I think we can fight this disease and win over it, you know.
Perfect. Very interesting. Very interesting. One last question, and this is a good question. This is a funny question. So one of our viewers, Ranjan, is asking us. We've heard that sanitizers with more than 60% alcohol are considered good for hand wash. Will drinking alcohol be of any help in fighting against coronavirus?
No, I think because you are drinking 40% or 40 proof, you know. So I don't think you know, have you read that study? Yesterday it came that 300 people in Iran died because some social media said that if you drink ethanol 70%, you know, your body will kill. And all those guys who had 70% ethanol, 300 people died. Just imagine. So I think ethanol is not a preventive. But yes, maybe maybe relaxation, it's good, but not as a sanitizer. The better sanitizer will be, again, soap and water and added with little sanitizers. So, but I don't think, I would not like to really spend too much of money. I would rather prefer to have a cheap soap and running water, which is the best way to sanitize yourself. And of course, for maybe off the record, for your sanitization of your soul and to get away your panic reaction, maybe a small drink is okay. But the panic reaction should be removed by having the knowledge about this particular, some very simple knowledge which you have to basically know. And I would advise, keep away from the social media. Just don't download those social medias. Don't forward those social medias. Just stick to WHO site, which will get exact picture what needs to be done. Social media has to be avoided.
Perfect. Right. So, Ranjan, I'm sorry to inform you that although drinking alcohol might not help you, but listening to Dr. Pradeep Chowbey will certainly add a lot of value. So, to our viewers, I would like to add here that I really cannot emphasize enough on every word and every single piece of advice that Dr. Chowbey has been extremely kind enough to share with us. These are difficult times indeed, but let us all take a moment to reflect on our lives and see this as a period of opportunity. I would like to thank Dr. Chowbey for joining us today. On behalf of all our viewers and SpeakIn team, you have our sincerest gratitude for sharing some very critical points that we urgently needed to listen to. I'm sure that our viewers will immensely benefit from your words. To all the viewers out there, to hear more from Dr. Chowbey, please do visit our website. And if you like this video, please do not forget to give it a big thumbs up and share the knowledge with your friends and with your families. Also, stay safe and maintain social distancing. We are in this together. Thank you so much, Dr. Chowbey, for joining us. I wish safety and good health for you and your family. Have a great day ahead. My name is Himanshu, and I'm happy to be speaking with you.